Today, we recognize the accomplishments of Black Canadians and honor the contributions they've made to our society. Black people have a rich history in this province, but this always hasn't been highlighted in public celebrations, educational publications, or the media. Since Canada first began officially celebrating Black History Month in 1995. But you know what? We've been changing the narrative. We are thrilled to be able to celebrate the important role that Black people have played and continue to play in Newfoundland and Labrador, and to provide a platform for Black voices. There's much for us to talk about, much for us to learn, but as you'll see today, there's also so much joy that comes from sharing these achievements, listening to these stories, and dancing to the music, which is a bit of a spoiler alert of what's yet to come. To launch our event, we would like to welcome Megan Morris, our Executive Director at the Association for New Canadians, to officially open our celebrations. Megan?
This month marks the 26th anniversary of the first national declaration of Black History Month in Canada. As we remember and honor the legacies and achievements of Black Canadians, it is important to continue our unwavering efforts to help build a more inclusive society. As an immigrant-serving agency, the Association for New Canadians is firmly committed to promoting, celebrating, and elevating the work of Black Canadians here in Newfoundland and Labrador and across the country. We remain committed to continuing our work to promote true allyship while helping eliminate racism, discrimination, and prejudice in our society. Thank you.
Thank you, Megan. All right, everybody, let's get the celebration started. First up, have you ever heard of resume whitening? Don't worry. If you haven't, we are grateful to have Dr. Bolo Ojimeni with us to introduce this topic. Now, Dr. Bolo is a medical dermatologist, clinical assistant professor, and assistant dean of social accountability in Memorial University of Newfoundland's Faculty of Medicine. An anti-racism advocate, he has given a TEDx talk, several keynote speeches in the area of diversity and anti-racism for academic and for community-based audiences. He has been published in the New York Times, the Globe and Mail, National Post, CBC, and the Huffington Post. The ANC was fortunate to have Dr. Bolo with us at our Idea Summit 2021, and we are happy to share this presentation with you today. Everyone, here's Dr. Bolo.
All right, so I was applying to work in a restaurant when I was in high school, and, you know, I put my application in, and it was several weeks or month. I was like, oh, you know, when are they, maybe they haven't called back yet. One of my, you know, acquaintances that I knew, and he actually happened to work there. So I said, you know, what happened to the resume? Like, are they calling people back? Should I just, you know, keep on applying? I've already put out 40 resumes. And he said, oh, that was you. Yeah, I talked to my manager. She said, yeah, she said she saw your name there. It was like Buluwaji Okunyemi. She just put it in the reject pile. So, you know, she said, there's so many people applying. I don't know how to pronounce his name. So she put in the reject pile. Okay, yeah, I'll tell her, yeah. And, you know, I can vouch for you. I'll tell her to consider you. So she did. She gave me a call. And I worked at that restaurant for the whole summer. It was actually a very good experience. So that goes to show that, you know, at many different levels, there's obstacles. So this one's interesting, hits home, I'm sure, for many. I see many racialized folks here. The first part is about who engages in resume whitening, why are they doing it, and what is it? So, for example, they felt that Lei Zhang was more associated with being East Asian, whereas Luke Zhang might be more associated with Asian American or Asian Canadian. Lamar James Smith was more associated with being Black American, where L. James Smith didn't really have that connotation. So this study was actually done out of the Rotman School of Management in Toronto, but the data comes from the US. And experience whitening is important as well, right? So for example, Black Student Association might be left off altogether, and the Chinese Christian Fellowship might just be called the Christian Fellowship, so it doesn't have that racial stigmata. So this is not me, but this is similar to me with my resume in hand. And, you know, so myself and many other folks I know actually do that, right? So we'll change the name a little bit just so it doesn't seem, you know, it seems more kind of fitting what the company wants. I already gave that example about the restaurant, right? About the name that they couldn't pronounce. Sometimes I'll go by Bo instead of Boluwaji. It is quite unfortunate. So now, I'm sure some folks want to know, does that actually work, right? Does that make a difference in how you present yourself? So they took 800 recent college graduates. So here the cases weren't real, but the people assessing them were real. These were real jobs in 16 diverse US cities. Everything else was the same, except some did resume whitening and some didn't. So the answer, as you can see, if you leave your kind of your CV as it is, you leave all the experiences on, you leave the ethnic name, if you will, callback is going to be 10, 11%. If you change your name a little bit, so Boluwaji goes to Bo, 14%. So more likely to get a callback. If you leave off things like the political affairs officer of Black Students Association, or Muslim Students Association, et cetera, or even many of the organizations you're with, more likely to get called back. And if you do both, you're over twice as likely to get called back. So that's data, right? So we can't refute it. I think many of us have anecdotes, but it's nice to see the actual data. Interestingly, even for equal opportunity employers, right? So many of you have or have seen, will say, we value diversity and we really value, the trend is the exact same.
Thank you for staying tuned. Next up, we've got St. John's very own King Sway. Now, King Sway's career began when he moved to Newfoundland. His first single, Savage Mode, was released January of 2018. He is known for his witty wordplay, curious sound, and creative style that combines stories of pain and a sense of uneasiness with melodies that hit the heart at just the right spot. His sound transcends any particular genre. Known for crossing over from rap to dancehall, R&B, and pop, he is also one of the hosts of CBC series Stuffed. He recently was nominated by Music NL for multiple awards, and you can also find his music on YouTube, Spotify. So with no further ado, everyone, here is King Sway.
This time I'm making it clear, please do not just disappear, because 2020...
My name is Farai Gwasira, and I go by the name King Sway. I am 23 years old, and I am a hip-hop artist currently based in St. John's, Canada. But my music started at about the age of 10 when I was still in Zimbabwe. I started off writing pop songs before puberty hit, because I was a bit more of a singer at the time. And as time progressed, it kind of went from a hobby into a coping mechanism, especially after my voice broke and I went more into hip hop and started dabbling around like other genres. But I found hip hop to be kind of my favorite space. And at the time I was listening to a mix, like I jumped from Akon to Lil Wayne to other artists. So it kind of nurtured where I wanted to take my music. And then when I was deciding where to go for university after I finished high school, it seemed like the next big hub of music was going to be Canada. So that's where I found myself. And that's how I chose where I'd go for university, because that's what I wanted out of life. I didn't see myself kind of sitting behind a desk for the rest of my life. I wanted a job that could explore all my talents. So I found myself here. I did my degree at MUN. And during the course of my degree, there was a lot of negative pressure, you know, that feeling that you need to get a job, you need to kind of focus on things that bring money in on the here and now. But fortunately enough for me, I was kind of surrounded by people who believed in my dreams, people who wanted to see me achieve my goals and reach my potential. So despite the pressure not to, I did continue with my music. And in 2020, I released my debut album, Daydreaming, which is technically when I believe my music career started, because it got me that traction where I could now call myself a musician outside of my friend groups. And that kind of progressive momentum led to the song we're about to listen to. It's called Winter. It was, funny enough, written in winter. In the middle of the night, it's about love and loss in a relationship that turns sour, and how the things that we have, we, after a while, you start to take it for granted and you don't realize what you had until it's gone. So after finishing my degree, which I actually finished pretty recently, it's only just December, I decided that I was going to try and stay here in St. John's because it's kind of become a home for me. I love the sense of community, the people. I feel like there's a lot of opportunities to not just grow as an artist, but grow as a person. Something which I feel like a lot of other artists don't see. I think there's a lot of brain drain in terms of creatives here because people assume you have to leave in order to further your craft. And I kind of want to prove that that's not the case. It's just dependent on who you are. So I'm here in the 709, enjoying my time. And working on my second album, and it's been amazing. Okay, so now we're going to watch the video for my song Winter.
This wasn't easy. I'm just feeling like you need me. I've been feeling like you pulled back. Yeah, I'm sorry, baby, just believe me. Why do you keep me? I know you're planning on leaving. I know you look for a better man, so you never feel like you need me. Feel like you need me. I mean, it's hard for me. I feel like I'm losing a part of me. You haven't been acting the same, and lately you don't even tell me you're bothering me. Baby, you gotta be, you oughta be losing. You show me a whole different side of me, saying you love me but you hate the side of me. Passive aggressive, I need an apology. Please just acknowledge me. If I got it, then tell me I got it. G, I need somebody that's in it for me. Wanna be toxic, if I'm being honest, then probably. But I need you here. This time I'm making it clear. Please do not just disappear, because 2020 has already been hell of a year.
I don't even put up with guys like you anymore. It's not me. I don't need you.
That was absolutely amazing. And imagine, he's right here in St. John's. What more could we want? All right, everybody, Kingsway will be back, so do stay tuned. So next we have up Black Voices Collective, through the Association for New Canadian. Now, this role arose from the Black community's need for their voices to be heard. In the past 2 years, in particular, the media has exposed incidents of violence against Black people around the world. This committee addresses programming needs of the Black community in Newfoundland and Labrador. So we couldn't have Black history without having a few of our Black Voices Collective members given a shout out for Black history.
Hi, my name is Nicole Obiodiaka, and I am the president of the Black Students Association at MUN, and I am also the Black Students Representative for CFSNL, and I sit on the Black Voices Collective panel for ANC. And my message for you this Black History Month is one of my favorite quotes from Ella Fitzgerald, and it goes, "Just don't give up on what you're trying to do. Where there is love and inspiration, I don't think you can do wrong." So take that message and apply it with you for any projects or any advocacy programs that you may be working on this Black History Month and beyond.
Hello, my name is Abdul. I am an international student at Grenfell campus of Memorial University. I'm studying my PhD in transdisciplinary sustainability. So I'm reaching you from Cornerbrook on the West Coast. My perspective on being Black in Newfoundland is that it is both exciting and challenging. Exciting in the sense that, you know, people generally are nice, and I think there are opportunities for you to, you know, grow if you want to do so in the province. But the challenge mostly comes for me sometimes when I crave for that authentic African dish and I cannot find, you know, my cultural or African dishes. So I have to kind of order from St. John's or even other places like Toronto, where there are lots of more Africans there than here. And I just want to wish everyone a happy Black History Month from the West Coast.
My name is Takudzwa Regis Chiwaya. A lot of people know me as TK or Regis. I came here to St. John's, Newfoundland and Labrador in 2016. So I've been here for 5 years. And I studied an International Bachelor of Arts at Memorial University. Currently, I'm an Immigration Pathways Officer with the Association for New Canadians. My perspective of being Black in Newfoundland, you know, it does have its ups and downs. I remember when I first came here, it was kind of a scary thought because, you know, I was not used to an environment where I was the minority coming from Zimbabwe, my home country. But after a couple of years, you know, you start getting used to it because people here in Newfoundland and Labrador are very welcoming. And that makes, you know, your transition here in Newfoundland easier. And I also like the fact that St. John's is becoming, you know, multicultural as compared to when I came here in St. John's 5 years ago. Right now we have, you know, a lot of different cultures from all over the world. We have different eating spots now, which is, you know, great. Because if I compare it to when I came here 5 years ago, there were not really a lot of things out there for St. John's to offer. But now I think the town has grown.
Hello, everybody. My name is Julius Pare Joseph, a singer, a songwriter, and I'm also a part of Black Voice Collective by the Association for New Canadians. The Association for New Canadians has been instrumental for my settlement here in St. John. Last year, I released my album due to the situation that was pulling down our energy, not only me, the entire world. So, and the album title is Wake Up. And the song that inspired me so much in the album is Black and White. What inspired me so much to come up with that song is one of my friends was in a relationship with a white lady. And then her family, due to how happy they were, they decided to wanted to proceed with the marriage. But then her family declined the wedding. Then it was so disappointed and heartbreak. And from there, it inspired me to come up with this song, which is called Black and White. From Julius Pare Joseph, known as Zuba 4000 KG, let's celebrate Black Excellence this month. Enjoy my music, and also on YouTube, Zuba 4000 KG, that's where you can find the song. On Spotify, Zuba 4000 KG, on Apple Music, Zuba 4000 KG. You name it, any platform, you're gonna get all the album right in front of you.
You took away my baby, you took away my lady. She said we're gonna be together. She said it will be forever. Aye. She said it will be forever. She said we're gonna be together. Aye. I wish it like returns together so I could do what I didn't do. She's so loving, fire. She's amazing, fire. She's so loving, fire. She's amazing. I literally fire myself. You took away my baby, you took away my lady, you took away my baby, and the bala, and she's black and white.
Wow, imagine that. Julius Joseph Pare released his album, and you heard him for yourself, and you heard his video. This is the talent that we have in this province. Next up, we have our spotlight on Black entrepreneurs in NL. Now, the Black community has been contributing to Newfoundland's economy in so many wonderful ways. Business owners employ people, they support their children, events and teams, and give back to the communities that they serve. There are so many Black entrepreneurs who have made it their mission to support our towns and cities right here in Newfoundland. From haircuts to clothing alterations, Black business owners are meeting the needs of the community. So first up, we have Zainab Jarrett. Now, Zainab hails from Nigeria, and she is the founder of We Care Foundation of Newfoundland and Labrador, Inc. The mission of her organization is to carry out humanitarian activities. Now, We Care Foundation creates and implements humanitarian programs and activities to support those in need within and outside of Newfoundland and Labrador. Zainab is also the organizer for the Trombolo Multicultural Festival. Let's hear her story.
Okay, thank you for having me. My name is Zainab Jarrett. I'm the founder and president of the We Care Foundation of Newfoundland and Labrador. Well, we started We Care Foundation in 2015, mainly to support girls who were kidnapped and denied education in northeastern Nigeria by the Boko Haram militants. But the organization grew and changed into serving not just girls in northeastern Nigeria, but newcomers and immigrants living here in Newfoundland and Labrador. We started in 2015, so technically now it's about 6 years. We also have a Trombolo Multicultural Festival Newfoundland and Labrador. That's a very big organization. It is a non-profit, just like the We Care Foundation. Trombolo is a non-profit organization, and we organize festivals and multicultural events across Newfoundland and Labrador to promote the arts, to promote cultural diversity, intercultural understanding, and immigrant integration and retention in the province. Well, it was actually created in 2009 by a couple who now live in Admiral's Cove. And actually, initially, they were partnering with the Association for New Canadians to provide opportunities for newcomers to get to know Newfoundlanders in a festive way. So they started it in Fairyland. So they will bus newcomers here in St. John's from the Association for New Canadians and some international students at Mon, and they will go to Fairyland and perform their music, their dances, do fashion show. And I was initially a caterer. I would cook multicultural food for the event in Fairyland. So they did it for 2 years, and it became like too much for them, and they wanted to abandon that particular project. So I decided to take over with their permission, and I registered it with the government as a non-profit organization. And since then, we've been working in partnership with the government of Canada through the Canadian Heritage. We get some support also from the provincial government in some ways, and SNL and other funders. So it has grown so big that now we are all over the province organizing events. For the future of We Care Foundation, we expect it to grow bigger, to do more for newcomers here, and actually not just newcomers, but all people who are underprivileged, people who are vulnerable, women, girls, to LGBTQIA+, seniors. We want to do more to support them, provide people with food hampers, work with our local partners here to provide counseling support for those having mental issues or need counseling for any kind of problems they have, provide food hampers, feminine hygiene products, and a lot of things to people who need help. We'll continue to do that. And for Tombolo, of course, we'll continue with our festivals, our events to promote cultural diversity, integration for newcomers, as well as support people who are in the arts across the province. We need to be united, help one another, but also reach out to other people in the community, people from the local population, people from other ethnocultural groups. We should work together and make Newfoundland and Labrador a great place for everybody.
That was amazing. All the wonderful things that Zainab is doing. Up next, we have Queensley Okinawa, the owner of Apeke Couture. Now, Queensley will talk about her business and overcoming obstacles when arriving here in Newfoundland. Everybody, here's Queensley.
My name is Queensley Okine. I am the creative director at Apeke Couture. My experience in Newfoundland. When we just moved to Newfoundland, it was a little bit different. Coming from Ottawa, and now moving to this place, it was like two extremes. And I began to calculate, how do I get a job? How do I get this? How do I get that? Because it just seemed like it was far from everything. And my husband told me, he's like, whatever it is that you're lacking here, it is an opportunity to start something or get something in. And that's how Apeke Couture started. Well, Newfoundland is a beautiful place. It is a beautiful place. It is like a community. It's like everybody just seems to know everybody. It is a place, a virgin place to start something. If you're thinking about doing something, starting in a business, this is a beautiful place to start. See, if we all just keep going back to the big city, it's gonna just remain the same thing, okay? We can stay here and put in the effort and do whatever it is that we need to do to make it happen. Apeke Couture, here, we do custom made, we do alterations, we do ready to wear, all kinds of tailoring needs. We're on 50 Monte Pond Road, and our phone number is 709-631-3312. Our email is sales@apekecouture.ca. Our Instagram handle is apekecouture.nl. Apekecouture.nl, sorry. So yeah, that's it. Just like I said, let's stay and make it happen.
Now, next in line, keeping the idea of design, but taking it from what we wear to how we style what? Our hair. Hear that rhyme? I'm already getting inspired. Next up, everybody, we've got Yao Antwi Aji. He is the co-owner of 1949 Barbershop. When Yao first started the business, the focus was mainly cutting Afro hair. But over time, their business started to grow, and so did the diversity of their staff and clientele. They have barbers from all over the world and are now referred to as the UN of barbershops. They have recently expanded their business to the Village Mall, opening another location there. Let's listen to their story.
My name is Yao Ncheje from Ghana, West Africa. Yeah, and I moved to Newfoundland in 2016 to pursue my master's degree. I did master's in philosophy, humanities, yeah. Well, this is 1949 Barbershop. And we've been in business since 2015. My business partner, as you may, that's Gustavo. We have two locations. And we started from Mayor Avenue, around Rabbit Town, where like we were predominantly Afro barbers. Like, we used to cut blacks mostly. And then business started growing. We started getting the locals, and now everybody comes here. So it's a hub for like almost everyone. It's a very diverse environment for people to show up and get haircut here. Currently, this location, we have 7, and the location on Tobe Road, we have 6. So in total, we're talking about 13, and we have 2 apprentices as well. So that makes it like 15 in total, yeah. So the long-term plan is to expand to other parts of the province. Challenge that I can readily recall is to find barbers who can do what we do here, like cut hair of all texture, like Afro hair, Caucasian hair, Latino hair, like almost every hair that we do here. It's so hard to find a barber who has that kind of talent. So mostly we do train our barbers. And that has been the biggest challenge, because in most cases we kind of have empty seats, especially when we are busy. And then that's the main challenge. And the other challenge too, I can really mention, is like the operational cost in the COVID time. So what I can say to my fellow immigrants coming into this province is, this province has a vast land and a big opportunities. It's up to you, the individual, to tap into these opportunities and make good use of it. If we all want to depend on like someone creating a job for you to jump on, because not everybody will be able to get a job. So once you are able to come up with some ideas on how to create jobs or how to start a business, I think there are several avenues around that you can seek the assistance. If you go to, I would say, in our case, we haven't sought for any external assistance, because we keep brainstorming what to do, where to get funds and all that. But I'm sure there are several avenues around the city where one can sort for like assistance if you want to start a business. So I would encourage like people who are coming into the province, especially the black community, to take that initiative and try to create something that will be beneficial to the community and then the people in the community as well. So happy Black History Month.
Was an amazing story, and thanks Yao for sharing with us. So next, we have some entertainment by the members of the Association for New Canadians Youth Black Voices Collective. All of the members attend Gonzaga High School, and their youth settlement counselor, Amani Fazi, helped facilitate a meeting and a subsequent connection. Here to perform their Afro dance, please welcome Ushandi, the group leader and choreographer, Sabora, Bernadette, and Daniel. Here we go with Youth Black Voices Collective.
Best you end up messing with.
amazing. I mean, I wish I could pop and lock and drop like y'all, but, you know, maybe in another time 20 years ago. Thank you. You'll all definitely have a future in the arts, and thank you so much again for sharing your talent with us. Now, this is a lovely segue to introducing our next artist and creator, Bushra Junaid. Bushra is a Canadian artist, curator, and an arts administrator based in Toronto. She grew up in St. John's and is best known for exploring history, memory, and culture identity through mixed media collage drawings and paintings. Born in Montreal to Jamaican and Nigerian parents and raised in St. John's, Junaid's work frequently engages themes of blackness, the African diaspora, and the history of the Atlantic Canada. Now, we had the pleasure of welcoming Bushra to our Idea Summit 2021, where the audience was captivated by her discussion of Black history here in the province and her experiences growing up here in St. John's. Now, if you weren't able to attend the Idea Summit or haven't yet viewed the recordings on our YouTube channel, we are delighted to be able to share some of Bushra's points on slavery here in Newfoundland and Labrador. Now, please welcome Bushra.
In 2014, I proposed an artistic project to Eastern Edge Gallery, an artist-run center in downtown St. John's, called the Newfoundlands Project. It explored colonial, economic, social, linguistic, and culinary connections between Newfoundland and Labrador and the Caribbean. The Newfoundlands Project opened at Eastern Edge in September 2016, and it featured Newfoundland and Ontario-based artists of Caribbean background, included performances, exhibition of artworks, lectures, and a Newfoundland-Caribbean fusion dinner. I invited a Black woman with Nova Scotian and Caribbean roots, Pamela Edmonds, to co-curate the exhibition with me. Through my work for the Newfoundlands Project, I learned that Newfoundland and Labrador, Through my research for the Newfoundlands Project, I learned that Black history is an inextricable part of Newfoundland history. The historical Black presence, as documented in archives and archaeological records, shows that enslaved people clearly existed in the early settlements on Newfoundland. Slave traders, merchants, and ship captains formed partnerships to commission some 19 ships built in Newfoundland and Labrador that were used in the transatlantic slave trade. These vessels were weighted down with ballast to make their way first to England to be outfitted with tools, weapons, rum, and other goods. From there, they sailed on to West Africa to collect abducted men, women, and children and transport them to the Caribbean, where they were enslaved. My own foreign mother, Sissa, was only a teenager when she was forcibly brought from West Africa to the Caribbean in horrific conditions in the holds of a slave ship. I don't know exactly when or on which vessel she may have made that perilous journey called the Middle Passage. Perhaps it was even on one of these ships constructed right here in Newfoundland and Labrador. Once they reached the New World, my ancestors and other Africans were enslaved on plantations. They labored to produce cash crops like cotton, sugar, and their derivatives, molasses, and rum. The traders carried these commodities back to Europe and North America to produce rum, textiles, and other sought-after items. In the 18th and 19th centuries, Newfoundland was Great Britain's most valuable fishing colony, an economic powerhouse that produced and salted preserved codfish or saltfish for international trade. And the Caribbean was a major market for Newfoundland saltfish. Plantation owners purchased large quantities of this saltfish as it was a cheap source of protein for the people they had enslaved. Just to give you a sense of how important the Caribbean market was for the Newfoundland fishery industry, when the British Parliament held a debate on the question of whether to abolish the slave trade in 1789, some parliamentarians worried that abolition would destroy Newfoundland. The island depended on its fishery, which in turn depended on selling vast amounts of the lowest grade of codfish to plantation owners. This inferior grade of fish, they pointed out, was quite unfit for any other market. And much of the salt used to preserve codfish before refrigeration, or before the advent of refrigeration, was mined by enslaved Africans on islands like the Turks and Caicos. The experience of one formerly enslaved woman, Mary Prince, was documented in the history of Mary Prince, a West African slave related by herself, which she recounted to English-born Canadian writer Susanna Moody. Prince described standing in a salt pan from dawn to dusk in the blistering heat with boils caused by the salt on her feet, legs and feet, and with little nourishment. The Caribbean continued to be an important market for buying a Newfoundland saltfish after the abolition of slavery in the British Empire and well into the 1840s and 1850s. But by the turn of the 20th century, the memory of this historical connection between Newfoundland and the transatlantic slave trade had faded. However, traces of it were still visible. Ads for molasses, sugar, rum, and other commodities produced by and for the West Indian market appeared in the St. John's Evening Telegram. References to shipbuilding and shipping ran alongside ads for insurance companies that had insured slave vessels and their human cargo some decades earlier. For the Newfoundland Project, my research reflected on these commodities that I mentioned that were traded between here and the Caribbean, sugar, molasses, rum, salt, fish, etc., and all on these archival ads from Newfoundland newspapers. In my research, I also considered what Africans had carried with them on their journey to the New World, the languages, art practices, music, dance forms, skills, etc., that they carried with them. Few Newfoundlanders today realize the influence of this trade in commodities on their foodways and cultural traditions. But if you look at everyday Newfoundland artifacts, from the molasses barrel that you may have grown up with, or other packaging, to rum barrels and bottles, you'll see they reveal that these cultural traditions originated in a centuries-long trade relationship that involved both provisioning and receiving the products of slavery. And Newfoundlanders and Caribbean people are all still connected through these foods, all still eat saltfish. Fish and brews for Newfoundlanders, saltfish with ackee, the fruit of that tree that originated in West Africa that I mentioned earlier, that was carried in the late 1700s on slave trips to the Caribbean, and green vegetables like cabbage, callaloo, and okra from the Caribbean. And we all consume molasses and rum. Newfoundland's peach is, in fact, as Jamaican rum is one example. What difference it might have meant for me as a child to know how the Caribbean had contributed to the settlement and development of Newfoundland and Labrador, and that I had as much right to call it home as any other belonging, as any other Newfoundlander.
That's amazing history, and it's only now becoming widely known. We are grateful to Bushra for enlightening us on this topic. Now, as I promised earlier, King Sway is back. He will discuss what it's like to be Black in Newfoundland and Labrador while facing mental health issues.
Okay, so the second song we're going to listen to today is called Addiction. Now, the story behind addiction is actually quite a personal one. It deals with my mental health and my experiences with what mental health is, because I believe that everyone kind of goes through the same thing, but in different ways. And I'd say probably from 2019 to 2021 was when I'd say it was hardest for me. It was at a time where I was dealing with depression, anxiety, a sense of loss, and part of that loss was a loss of purpose. And that's what that song touches on. It touches on how, even though I had all these things going on, I still felt like I was lost in the world, and how, even though I wasn't actually alone, it's very easy to feel alone. It's very easy to feel isolated in amongst a group of people, especially when you've come to a new country, you're in a new career where you don't feel as much support from the people that you want to be supported by. And the accumulation of all of that is just, you end up in a very dark place. My message to those who do go through mental health struggles is it does get better. A lot of the times you don't want to do the things that are prescribed to you because in the short term, it doesn't feel like it really does anything. But in the long term, when you make that effort to go for a walk here and there, when you make that effort to do things that you love and force yourself outside your comfort zone, it does get better. And I'm personally one who tried to do it without the medication because I felt like it was impacting my music. Like my creativity was a bit less. So I had to kind of find ways to fill my time and never be idle, which was difficult because, you know, there's this feeling when you get up in the morning that I don't want to do anything today. I just want to stay in bed. I want to stay in this kind of like security blanket that I'm in the morning. But over time, it does get better. There are a lot of resources here. We have the mental health line. We have counselors. There are people who are ready and willing to help. And no matter how lonely it does feel, you're never alone. And I always encourage my fans to reach out and share stories because there is some sense of comfort in kind of talking to people who've been through something similar. And I'm always down to respond. You know, of course, over time, as the music grows, it is a bit harder to keep track, but I always do my best. So that is my one message to y'all. Just keep the faith. So now we're going to listen to the song Addiction. I hope that you guys enjoy and that you have something to take away from it. And happy Black History Month.
To get bullied when I was a child, and I would just bottle and keep it inside. I did all the pills, but somehow survived. My honesty speaking, there's God on my side. How many times in a week could I die? How many times did I try? So he told me, you don't mean it, man. Why the hell would I lie? See, I would pop pills just to get by. I was so low that I get high. Two blunts at the same time. Yeah, I hate smoke, but I feel fine. Heard things through the grapevine, but I press on till I make wine. If you throw shade, then we outshine. You know, good things really take time. Praying hard for these better days. Summertime, sipping lemonade. I'm a prisoner to my mental state. You know bad is better when you feel insane. Y'all niggas made me feel a way. It's a struggle for me each and every day. But you never know me till you know my pain. Till you see my picture taken out of frame. If you wanna die every single day, suicide is just not the way. I know it's hypocritical for me to say, but I do believe there'll be better days. I go through it too and I feel your pain. I prefer to cry walking in the rain. They don't understand you, they don't feel the pain. But I'm here for you if you need a thing.
Day to day, I'm fighting the demons in my head, in my head. Go around asking all these questions like they get. Father, can you hear me now? I've been going through this for a while. At the end of the day when the sun set, just know you're not alone.
That was amazing insight into what people suffering with mental issues go through daily. We appreciate his openness in sharing his coping strategies. What time is it? Oh my goodness, it's time already. Well, that's it for us, folks. Thanks for hanging out with me today to celebrate Black History and Black Excellence 2022. Thanks to our team and our guests for making this event happen. Happy Black History, everybody, and see you all next year.
But I'm here for you if you need a thing.
Day to day, I'm fighting off the demons in my head, in my head. Go around asking all these questions like they get. Father, can you hear me now? I've been going through this for a while. End of the day when the sun set, just know you're not alone. Oh, just know you're not alone. Oh,
so let me just tell you where you were.
Thank you. This program is brought to you by Ignite TV. Now you're in command. Visit Rogers.com for more details.